So he says he's a show fan. He said, what?
I have no idea what he is.
Love the show. Great stuff. I love the depth you go into.
And you know I'm not Bob Heil.
Yes, I know you're not Bob Heil.
Okay. So, and I know who you are. I don't have to ask.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
And he's still saying, what are we talking
Can
about?
Can I get your autograph?
I'm figuring it out. I wanted to tell you how much I appreciate your videos. They're really good.
You well know done. I'm not Bob Heil.
I know.
Okay, who are you?
I'm Rod Mallory. I just got my ticket less than a month ago.
What's that shiny new call sign?
KM4SDG.
Okay, go ahead and tell me. You got into ham radio because of watching my show.
Well, no, I got into your show because of ham radio.
Okay.
But I took both the tech and the general the same day and passed them both. And I'm studying for my extra now. So.
Yay. Congratulations and welcome. Glad to have you here.
Appreciate it. But I really appreciate, because you do a good job with that. And I just, as an ex-photographer myself, I think this is really well done. And I appreciate it.
About to do a television show here. Really a lot of good information.
Okay, Dave, pick up the microphone. I caught you doing your job.
Microphone in, close enough?
Very close, there you go.
Microphone in hand, yeah.
I caught you doing your job. Oh, wait a minute. This is Ham Radio Now episode. This could be the auspicious episode 250.
Wow.
You know, the hundreds, the century marks, they're highly auspicious. This is half auspicious. Episode, I think it'll be 250 if I edit it right. And we're going to talk about the national traffic system. Pardon me a second.
Certainly.
I need a nap. There we go. National traffic system, right?
That's right. National traffic system. And yeah, you know, people have been known to snooze a little bit when it comes to this because,
well,
there's a lot that don't know what it's all about.
Yeah. So I've been a ham for 51 years. I've checked into NTS nets. And I've been making fun of them on the show now for the past couple of shows. Your license is about to expire. I spell echo, x-ray, pop. That's what it's all about, isn't it?
A lot of it is. A lot of it is. And there's reason behind that. In matter of perspective. My perspective, and we see a lot of that type of traffic, what that does, that helps us to be prepared to practice, or helps us to be prepared to send traffic in book format. In other words, say, for example, we have some sort of emergency.
Okay, I don't want to give everybody a tutorial on how traffic system works, because that will put everybody to sleep. I buried the lead. It's not NTS anymore. It's NTS D. That's the part I want to get into. But I guess we better talk a little bit about what the whole deal is. The ARL started as, I mean, the initials ARRL are American Radio Relay League. Why?
Correct. Very much so. And that is the one of the founding concepts of ARRL was transferring information, radiograms, cross-country, and getting information to other hams and to the local communities the hams lived in.
You weren't around when the ARL was founded, right?
Thank goodness.
And neither was I, but I've read the old QSTs. Back in the day, 1915, radios didn't talk very far.
Correct.
With spark, and the average ham was lucky to get across town or maybe to the next town 25, 30 miles away. So I shouldn't be telling this story. You should be telling this story. But Hiram Percy Maxim thought, well, okay, so I've got something I want to tell somebody, and he's out of range. How do I do it?
And there came the relay portion of the
event. You get the ham in the middle to copy the message. and pass it on.
Pass it on.
Of course, he miscopies it. He screws it up.
Well, that could happen. But, you know, today with the systems that we're working with, and even phone and digital is really good because there's not a whole lot of manipulation.
We'll get to that digital. You guys are waiting for that.
That's right. And on the phone side of that, we have checks and balances, just like you have in your bank account, to make sure that the traffic gets through accurately.
Eh, sort of. We've tested it. It doesn't work very well.
101%, no.
No. But back in the day, this was the thing. It was really important. And in the first 10 years or so, there were these tests, these practically contests, to see if a message could get from one side of the country to the other and back. And that was a big deal. I mean, there were big parts of the country where there weren't very many hams, and they had to find somebody in the middle to do that. You know, they're trying that today, trying to send APRS messages across, just up and down the Appalachian Mountain system.
Certainly.
2016,
certainly.
They're having trouble doing that.
That's right.
Because stations in the middle, they're missing. You know, they can't get somebody. So back in the day, the Spark stations and all this stuff, they're having fun trying to get this message across, and eventually they do it. I don't have the whole story. Is this lore passed on to all NTS people, or am I just a historian here?
No, that's right, and people that really care about it are interested in the history. And having
take
the right,
your no-dos now.
Right people in the right place, you'll get it done.
Okay, so let's fast forward to, oh, say, the middle of the century, in the 50s, after the wars, and at times when... when were you licensed? When did you first get in?
I'm a relative newcomer. I was licensed in 1975.
Okay. So, yeah, I got you by 10 years. So even back then, the national communications system, not the ham system, the stuff for everybody else, was the telephone. And that was not a very robust system. Worked okay as long as everything was fine.
Right.
But it could be knocked out by any given number of natural disasters. And so ham radio had a real important place.
That's right. And it actually has come to pass where amateur radio was a big help in everything from the Murrah building disaster on through the Boston Marathon. And amateur radio's uniqueness in its redundancy in being able to move any type of information is just been its boon, the
yeah.
boon for
when all else fails
radio. Absolutely.
So now we'll wind the clock closer to modern times, and we have far more than the phone system, and it's pretty darn robust, but it's not perfect, and it can still get blinked out now and then. What's the place of the national traffic system today?
Well, today I look at, we talk about oftentimes the last mile of communication. National traffic system practices this every day. In time of a disaster, when you need to get information in or out of an area, that's what we do. Again, every day we have traffic nets to move traffic cross country or across the street.
Okay, I wasn't going to do a whole tutorial, but there's still a mini tutorial. How does this work? Where does the message start?
Yeah, the message can start just about anywhere. If we were
does
to take,
it have to be a ham?
It does not have to be a ham, but it needs to go through a ham. So a ham will receive the traffic from, or a proposed message from a, let's say, civilian, a non-ham, and will help them edit the text of that message to fit into the radiogram, and then that ham will put it into the system.
Because you don't want a long message.
Brevity is there's a lot to be said for brevity.
The soul of wit.
That's it.
I have no soul. Okay, so but it, because of the way these things have been sent by Morse code and by voice, they had to be short.
That's right. The shorter the message is, the more accurate.
Yeah. Have we got a message pad here? There's one sitting over there. Yeah. there's space for 25 words.
25 words, that's right. And you know, that is essentially a recommendation to limit to 25 words. Yeah. And we do handle traffic with
The guy who invented Twitter was probably a ham who did NTS.
Probably so.
140 characters.
Probably so.
Just realize that.
There you go.
Okay, so so it's got to be short. At least the traditional stuff has to be short.
Correct.
Because of the way it got sent. Somebody comes up with a message, gets it to a ham. What does the ham do with it?
The ham will then take the message to a net. Nets on VHF repeater systems, or we can do simplex if need be. We have a lot of different methods worked out to that. From there, it can go to the section nets, which are typically HF, and then HF onto or even a CW net, and then get into the system itself to go cross country. Back to the digital thing.
I missed the section. Is that ARRL sections, like North Carolina's
section?
Pretty
much set up for by the ARRL section, correct.
Okay. So it gets there, and then how does it get out of the section? Say it started here in North Carolina, but it's heading for Los Angeles.
Then it might go from here to fourth region net, which is essentially the southeastern portion of the United States.
That's the 4 as in KN, 4AQW, 4DNA, the fourth region. Okay.
There you go. There you go.
It's got some new guys out there. They're not.
That's right. That's right.
To keep
so
up to speed.
Fourth region, it'll press on to the eastern area nets and then proceed across country.
Okay, fourth region, eastern area, and then how do we get from there to the West Coast?
And depending on what's needed, and it could go through a relay system to the central area, and then to the western, and then.
And then it works its way back down the chain.
That's right. That's right.
And, okay, so now it's now 3 weeks later and the message has arrived.
Oh, typically it takes anywhere from 24 to 48 hours to go cross-country. That's right.
It's not Pony Express. It's a little faster than that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And making all the right connects and having a good propagation helps.
Okay. And then it may reach a local VHF net?
Correct. If it's downloaded back there over in California, so to speak, through the through their regional nets into the local net, and then they go to a point of delivery, yep. Which would be a ham getting into that
and
net.
And he puts on his messenger bag and his hat and climbs on his motorcycle and drives to the guy's house.
Has several options. He can actually use a telephone.
Or the telephone. Why didn't I think of that? Great idea. Why didn't they use the telephone the first time?
My goodness.
In the old days, a long-distance call was expensive. Today, it's all free.
Absolutely.
Why not just call?
Well, what's the fun in using a telephone? You know a telephone's going to work, right? We
Most
want a
of
challenge.
The time.
Okay, so you want to challenge your backup systems and make sure they're going to work.
Okay, so it's not the primary system. Now we're getting to the meat of things. It's the backup system.
Sure.
Okay.
Correct.
For when all else fails.
That's it,
when
exactly.
None of the other stuff works.
Correct.
There we go. Is this still viable? Is there a place for it? Is there a reason to have this complicated system in place anymore?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
I get the impression that it could very well be just hams doing churn.
That's true. But here, this whole concept of this whole of the NTS is again as that opportunity to work that last mile. Here's again part of the concept. Communications goes out on the East Coast because of a storm that goes through. Every now and then there might be a hurricane that runs through and takes down the normal twisted pier. Your cell phone towers go out. The antennas for the cell phone systems go out of sync. That kind of thing. It takes a while to bring all that back online. Well, we have a way through this NTS system that's been practiced to that point to get that information out so that people know that their folks are okay, their friends and relatives are okay. And it doesn't necessarily have to go cross-country by NTS. If it's an emergency priority welfare type traffic, hey, if I get it here, my phone's working, I'll call California and let them know that they're okay.
Now you can do that for free. So
that's right.
So why not?
Absolutely.
So, because I've heard this described this way, get the message to the first working phone.
Absolutely.
And then, yeah, the rest of the ham radio stuff is cool and all, but if this is an important message and it's got some time component to it, don't churn the system.
That's
just
right.
Just get it to the first working phone.
Absolutely.
And off
Absolutely.
It goes. There's clearly an emergency component to this, but in the ARL structure, there's an emergency system. It's ARIES. It's not NTS.
I like
That's a challenge. Go ahead.
Oh, certainly, certainly. I kind of like to think, really, ARIES.
Nice and close.
ARIES is set up to take care of emergency management. That's their function. That's their focus. And it needs to be, because emergency management, my background is I was a fire chief at one time. Okay, in a full-time paid department. Okay, the Air Force. But you'll have times when you need the support outside of your capabilities. So ARIES is there to help emergency management to take care of those types of situations. I kind of look at NTS as being the section or the people that will take care of the victims of the emergency. While ARIES is focused on the emergency management as they need to be, we can help the rest of the folks that are involved in this situation, the unfortunate.
How do you do that?
Through being active or available in shelters. I've seen situations where people actually put signs in front of their houses saying, communications available here, so folks can get word out to their loved ones that they're okay.
I wish I had a better story than I'm about to tell, but I've been in shelters, and the ham sits quietly in the corner hoping no one notices, I guess. And every once in a while sends a message from the Red Cross volunteers saying, there are 15 people here, and we need two more cots or whatever. That's the kind of the extent of the message. I have never seen a ham round up messages from the people, even the times I was doing this before everybody had a cell phone, and say, I can let your relatives know you're okay. Would you like me to do that? And see their eyes light up and say, my God, I've been distraught that my kids know I'm in a hurricane zone and they can't reach me on the phone, and how was I going to tell them because there's no working phones? You telling me you can do that? Do we ever actually do that?
And that's what we need to do.
I'm going to take that as a no.
I've seen it done some places, but many, many, many times it does not happen.
Yeah,
there's a sheet that's available that can be used to hand around in a shelter environment, and it's a preset radiogram message preset radiogram
probably
message.
Probably blocking your camera. Yeah, it's doing a good job of that.
There you go, for health and welfare, and about all the person has to do is fill out the contact information and check a block.
Yeah, quick and easy stuff.
Sure.
So we could do it efficiently, but I guess my point is, and this is, it's kind of the way I do things, is to say, yeah, we polish the turd and say, this is really great, we can do all this, and then we never actually do it.
Sometimes people get tied up in the situation,
yeah,
and they lose sight of some of that stuff. And
if we had something big, and this happens now and then, Katrina was probably the last really big one, and let's use Katrina as an example. Did the NTS system get flooded with messages from people in the Superdome?
I don't think the communications was actually as available. I know that there were some locations, in particular as one hospital, where a ham was at the hospital and took care of a lot of communications for that. I believe that a lot of that, and I've talked to people that have been down to the Houston when they had their storm come through, and a lot of issues that have to be dealt with in that environment salt water gets into power lines and makes wreaks havoc with radio communications. So it makes it much, much more difficult. But to get out there and shake the bushes, so to speak, and get people the information that the communications is available.
Yeah. Well, these are the challenges that we're met with, and we try to deal with to get our communications through. But what I'm still going to keep pounding on is we say we can do it, we don't do very much of it. If a situation came up where there were five or six shelters in the eastern part of a state, and each one of them had 200 people in them, and every one of them wanted to send a message, could we do that? Do we have the capacity? Can we get that kind of throughput through our system?
I think we do here. We do have the capability. And again, going back to building book-type traffic, essentially traffic that goes to different addresses, but essentially say the same thing.
Same message.
I'm okay. Everything's good here.
So you don't have to send the same message over and over again. You just give an address.
Give an address.
All the different addresses, and then it's the same message.
Correct.
So that limits... For voice and CW nets, it limits how much you got to spend time on it.
And in the digital world,
NTS traffic side of digital. Hold the digital.
Hold the digital.
Just for a second, we'll
Pause.
Get to it. Okay, so I'm going to contend that we may have the capacity. I got a feeling that, and feel free to send me email. I got a feeling that if a couple of hundred people at five or six shelters each all came up with a message at once, that the system would shudder, if not collapse.
I'm kind of optimistic that we can be successful. It'll take time.
Has it ever happened?
There's no, not
In your
that I'm
experience,
aware of.
Has anything of that scale happened?
Not that I'm aware
Could
of.
It have, if the hams were there in place, proactively digging this stuff out and doing what we say we do?
I believe it could come close to it, because even if we had, shelters tend to be, there are a lot of places that we have large shelters, a lot of people involved, but most of the time they like to limit the size or number of people in any given shelter. So that's kind of a limiting factor, that kind of stuff. But then all that has to go into the system, routed in. So then you call on other resources and to be able to help that out.
Okay.
One of the things you could do is you have different operators, and different operators would go off to different frequencies and move for each shelter, for example. So there is potential, there's possibility to be able to deal with it as long as it's done wisely.
Okay. We have potential. We've had potential for a long time.
How do you test it?
Yeah.
Well, that would be a good thing.
It's 2016. We've had test after test after test.
Certainly.
We've had experience after experience. And as the communications infrastructure gets far more sophisticated and elaborate, yes, it gets more vulnerable in one sense, but just because there's so much of it, it also gets more available outside of ham radio.
Certainly.
I've stopped saying that cell phones can be blinked out in an instant, because the cell phone companies get mad. They say, no, we got battery backup, that's going to last for 24 hours. We got generators, that's going to kick things in for several days. If it gets worse than that, we've got infrastructure we bring in. Yeah, the whole system might not be up, but a lot of it still will be. So we got to stop telling the public, it's because all else fails, the phone system can disappear in an instant. I can't say that anymore. Okay, beat that horse. Its carcass is lying on the ground, and you're. The email that I'm starting to get now is, why is Dave still talking to you? You have done nothing but insult the system that he loves. Why is he still sitting there? But you are. So we'll go on.
Absolutely.
We'll go on to part two.
And happy to be.
Where I will contend that anyone speaking into a microphone, message traffic, is wasting their time. There's something better, and it's been around for a long time, and that is the D, an NTS D, digital.
Absolutely.
And I didn't know this existed.
Oh, well, that's the unfortunate thing. Hey, there are a lot of hams that don't know that NTS exists, so, understand that.
And so, the yay digital, for this show.
There you go.
Another 1,000 people or so will find out about it.
That's right. This is great. But the digital concept incorporates automatic operating stations that can move traffic very, very quickly, long distances, and that too has a structure. And just the second that, you know, that will go long distance when you get to the delivery point or the entry point, then you still have to have your phone systems or CW systems to bring it in. So then the operator at the digital station can input the traffic into the digital system and move it literally cross country and even overseas now. We do
so
have links into Europe.
It's still likely to initiate someplace on a voice or CW net.
Correct.
Now,
it can be direct. Sure, it can be direct if you
should
are.
Should it be?
We do have, there's kind of the limitations that system has to be policed. From the perspective of non-commercial, you know, all the things that you have to look at for NTS across the board, and what we do as hams, that it not be non-commercial, that it is no profanity, all those types of things that we watch for. So someone in there has to police that, and typically that's the entry point.
Okay.
So
I have a harder time asking questions now because all the stuff we talked about before I was familiar with because I'd participated in it. Now I'm groping in the dark. I used packet in the 90s.
Sure.
And I'm familiar with the bulletin board system. And yeah, you send a message in. You as the initiating station, the ham, are responsible for the content of that message. And eventually things got hammered out so that the stations along the line didn't have to take responsibility for it, which would have been unworkable because then it would have slowed things down. Because
right.
Every station in line, someone's going to have to read it and say, that's okay, we'll send this along.
Right.
Just the first station now. Same for whatever you're doing, right?
Yeah, pretty much. Similar to packet, but much more sophisticated from that perspective. It does not have to be checked at each point, the entry point and the end point. Are critical locations spot checked by the relay stations in between. Structure is set up to reflect what the NTS structure is with the start through finish of the system. And it's very, very robust. Error checking in the system, we're now moving from programs like, let's say, Winlink Classic to BPQ32, which is multifaceted, and error checking in those systems is just incredible. It's really very, very robust.
Are we talking about HF mostly, VHF? Where are these things found?
We can bring it in from VHF. Primarily, we deal with the HF side of it. The RMS wind leak system can be tied into the program. Windmore, which is another type of system for we can bring digital messages in using sound card as opposed to the more expensive SCS type modems.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of versatility.
The actual the layer of this system that is the digital software end of things is Pactor. The software hardware interface is
correct.
Pactor, if I got that
correct,
of which there are several levels.
Correct.
And progressively faster, a little wider bandwidth, and what else?
And that's true. We Pactor in the States now, we're limited to three levels of Pactor. Overseas in Europe, they can use a Pactor 4 level, which is pretty much easily twice the throughput of Pactor 3. But maybe someday we'll see our way to be able to use that in the United States, but the FCC needs to approve all that.
The low levels of Pactor, 1, maybe 2, available in any terminal node controller, any TNC?
There are some TNCs available that are not proprietary, so to speak, like the SCS modems are.
An old CAM that did a few modes, you know, it did packet, it did RIDI, and I think it did one version of Pactor.
Most likely Pactor 1, right.
Which was very slow.
Correct.
slow on everything. The Pactor didn't help. And then the faster levels, I understand, require a fairly expensive proprietary one-source modem.
And this is true at this point. And the company that came up with this, a German outfit that has this.
That's SCS?
SCS.
Okay.
Right, Sierra. They make good equipment. It works quite well, but it tends to be expensive. The prices have come down significantly. If you're not looking for something that has all the bells and whistles of Pactor 4, then you can get something in about the same that you would buy a mid-level, I guess, maybe mid to low-level radio.
HF radio?
HF radio, correct.
So it's $500 to $1,000.
Correct. And you can get used ones that are good as new. I mean, the equipment is very good. Okay. And a lot of people, they get on eBay and such and be able to operate 2 and 3.
When is the patent going to expire on that?
Beats the heck out of me. It is. But, you know, being a European company, they have different laws that govern that stuff. Okay. So they've been holding on to it.
Not about to open up to generic reproduction quite
unfortunately
yet.
It doesn't look like that.
Okay. Winmore is a system that was developed because Pactor was very expensive.
Correct.
It's sound card. It's like all the other digital data modes, the PSK31 switch is about the only one I can reference because it's the only one I'm very familiar with. But it's like that. You do your computer stuff, makes audio, and feed it into the microphone of your sideband transmitter.
Correct.
So yeah. Is Winmore free or is it?
Well, the programming itself is. It's the equipment you need to get, and it's like you say, it.
You need a little
sound card interface.
Type.
Sure. Right. Exactly. That will interface much more reasonable.
Okay.
Cost wise.
Is the thing Winmore does, is that Pactor?
No. But what it will do is with Winmore using the sound card interface, you can then interface it into the Pactor system. So there, in using the software that we use, the BPQ32, kind of brings all that together and allows us to transfer information very easily.
So if the station is sending Pactor using one of those expensive modems, can a ham using Winmore decode that?
I haven't used it yet to see exactly the way that interface is, how that
you
rolls
into it. You got the expensive
SCS. But, yeah, that's the thing.
Once you've got the Cadillac, you don't want to Chevy. Well,
but I want to bring that into my station.
Okay.
To make it available for others.
All right. So something we got to learn there.
That's right. There's a curve there.
What do I want to ask next? How is this system working today? Is this digital system handling the bulk of traffic?
No.
Moving across country right now?
No, I don't think so. We're still, we don't want to take a lot from the other systems. We want to make sure that the CW operators have their CW traffic opportunities and everyone else in the program and the process. Just another mode within NTS to move traffic.
How well accepted is it among the hams who are interested in doing this?
You know, it appeared to me early on there were some hams that were a bit concerned that it would steal or rob from the other programs, the other systems, but now it's very, very well accepted. I hear comments that, you know, from our old-time CW operators that, you know, hey, if you can get it through quicker than we can, then go ahead, you know, use that means. And usually that's like the time between nets more so than the speed of transfer of the data.
Because it's running automatic, or mostly right. Automatic. Is that CW operator likely to take the next step and say, I want to play the digital stuff?
Most of them, I don't think they want to get so much involved in the digital side of the house. Some of them do. I mean, some of them have. They're, again, you know.
Are we talking about 80-year-olds here?
Yeah, probably so and probably not, right? But what do they want to invest in what they're doing? You know,
I mean, are we seeing a generational thing? Is it the guys doing the digital are the younger, relatively 40s and 50s, and the guys
and 60s
hanging on
and,
to dear life with CW and sideband or the 60s, 70s, 80s?
There's quite a few that are older operators that are into it. You want to say my mentor from the western part of the state, he's got probably about 20 years on me, that initiated me in the digital world. So there's a lot of interest across the board. It depends on the ham. It's just like some people would love to do NTS. Some people, that's not my thing.
Hold
I'd rather
that
contest.
Mic real close there.
They'd rather contest than NTS. So everybody has their own thing. And that's what ham radio is all about.
Is doing
right?
the digital side as engaging as, sending a message on CW, you are doing it yourself. On phone,
right.
You are doing it yourself. On digital, you just like the equipment tender?
To a degree, all right? I'll say that.
You built
to
it.
A degree.
That was exciting.
Right.
You made it
put
work.
All this
that
system together, and it's successful. It's working. But sometimes
you go get lunch, and the system.
Well, there might be a failure in the system somewhere. Maybe the person I'm passing it off to has an equipment malfunction. Well, I have to find another route then.
Okay? So some manual stuff.
Yeah, there's some. I really got a job, and I still enjoy very much watching traffic move through the station. I get over 700 messages a month that'll roll through my station.
I'm flashing on the Matrix movie where the code is flying across the screen and the guy is now able to read that code. You're watching the traffic go through your system.
Probably not exactly like that, but you do see the originating station come online. You see the connects. You see the headers from the traffic as it passes through. And it's a lot of fun to see that and make sure, it's successful. You originate stuff. You put traffic into the system. There's a lot of opportunity.
Does not just the digital part, but the whole of NTS need lots more people? Is it just a shadow of what it really ought to be?
I would like to
see. That's a leading question, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I would like to see more people involved in it, and I think all of us would.
But does it need it?
I think it is. Because just like, again, it goes back to our premise in amateur radio. We talk about equipment, the systems that are available to us. The more you have, the more your opportunity to be successful. And that's what we want to be, successful. We want to get this stuff through.
Okay, I got you for about two more minutes before you got to go to an ARL forum. This automated station thing is heartburn to a certain subsection of hams, and I'm not sure how big they are, but I know how noisy they are. You walk on CW contacts all the time, willy-nilly, you just don't care?
It's kind of interesting. The system is set up so it will detect, and it refers to as a busy frequency. It will detect conversation, phone, CW, any other types of digital modes. What sometimes I've seen happen is there might be a pause between transferring traffic digitally, and someone will pick up on that and just jump right in without doing the listen before you transmit type
QRL.
Thing.
QRL.
Who would do something like that? Right. But it does happen. Some people that get upset about, understand that little segment, the very, very small segment that automatic stations are allowed to participate in or use. And people just don't see that in their spectrum plans because it's not there in a lot of them.
There's a very small segment where, because I looked this up before the Charlotte Ham Fest, very small segment where an automated station can initiate a transmission, but it can respond to a manual request on any frequency that it can legally operate on.
Correct.
In theory, the manual operator is hearing things, but as we know with propagation, you can't necessarily on a band like 20 meters or even 40 meters hear both sides of a contact. So there can be a ongoing contact and you don't hear it. And you may say, is the frequency in use or is it QRL? A bad ham. Mm-hmm. And for some reason the station that you'd be interfering with didn't catch it or whatever and doesn't know how to say
The channel's in use, old man. We've been using this frequency for the past 40 years. I like doing that.
I've been there. I've heard it.
In any case, the automated station can pop up.
Sure.
To these guys complaining about it, do they really have a leg to stand on, or are they just making noise?
I think they're making a lot of noise.
I got an empty chair sitting here. I should have one of them here.
There you go. Oh, well.
I'm not sure I can find one.
They're lost.
Yeah.
The thing is, you know, this is a band allocation for automatic stations. And just like, let's say, the window, right, for DX context. Now, if you jump into that window and you start transmitting to call somebody, your friend across town, guess what's going to happen to you?
Right? This is the DX window. Get the hell out of here.
That's right. Something like that. Now, we're not that crass. But
well, it's because you're automated. You're digital.
That's right.
They can't understand you. All they hear is, psh.
Yeah, sure. Yep. All that stuff is in there. But, you know, it's kind of interesting, the concepts of that we... that's going on here. That
damn hams, get off the lawn.
That's right.
All right. Is there anything you want to wrap this up with?
I just say that, you know, take a look at NTS and see what it's all about. Get a hold of somebody locally that knows and participates in NTS. Talk it up in your clubs. Ask if you're interested. You want to know something about it. There's a lot of folks out there that are participating.
It's a little bit of a wonky thing in ham radio. It can be a lot of fun.
Absolutely.
Well, listen to the nets and... they attract their share of people that say, this is what I want to do.
Yeah,
have I been grossly unfair to you in this interview?
I don't think so. You've been challenging. However, you know how that goes. But, you know, in NTSs, you know, the nets are structured. You know how we have structure in everything we do. Hey, that's what we're kind of used for. So when somebody comes off the wall like you do, well, you know, we can survive.
It's a good place for hams who don't feel comfortable rag chewing.
Absolutely.
But want to use the heck out of their radio.
And you know, the people that tend to like it are kind of like people that come out of the military because they're used to structure, right?
Yeah.
And NTS is about the most structured thing that's going on right now.
All right.
So it's an opportunity.
Thank you, Dave. I appreciate it. That will be it for this. We got to go to the ARL forum here. We are at the Raleigh, North Carolina Hamfest, by the way. I don't think I said that at the beginning. And thank you very much, Dave. Dave Roy, W4DNA, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, Arvin sitting back at the Ham Shack, and the studio would like you to stop by hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy me beating up people like Dave, then send a couple, but look at this. I got to show somebody. A guy came up to me. I'm not going to embarrass him by saying who he is. He came up to me just over there and said, I want to help out Arvin.
Wow. Fantastic.
You don't have to do that. The Patreon, $1 a month, would be wonderful. All right, see you guys. Over and out.
Yay. Thanks, Gary.